Good evening, and thanks everyone for coming. My name's Josh Brandon, and I'm with Green Action Center. And it's really my privilege to welcome you all to our event today, Tar Sands Pipelines and Tankers, a public forum on the Enbridge Northern Gateway Pipeline. We have a really amazing panel of speakers today, and you'll be introduced to them in a moment. It's really incredible, the turnout that we've had for this. It's really amazing to see so many people here. It's a testament to how important this issue is here in Winnipeg and right across the country. I'm from British Columbia originally, and I really think of our West Coast as one of our natural wonders, and it's part of our global heritage. So I'm really grateful for our panelists today for sharing their expertise and really talking about what's at risk, what's at stake with this pipeline project. Organizing for tonight's event started about a month ago on January 9th when the National Energy Board began its hearings on the pipeline. That same day, Natural Resources Minister Joe Oliver published a letter in the Globe and Mail where, you know, it's quite famous now. He talked about how environmental groups are pursuing this radical agenda, that they're trying to hijack the environmental assessment process and bringing in foreign interests to influence things. And for many environmentalists like myself, I was a bit concerned about the words that he was using. You know, if I think about environmental groups here in Manitoba, we're not exactly getting a lot of big cash from deep pockets. And I think I can assure you that there was no big, deep foreign funders for tonight's event. But there is one aspect of Joe Oliver's letter that I did agree with. He opened the letter by writing that Canada is on the edge of an historic choice. And I really think that's true. We organized this forum tonight to help ensure that people in Manitoba could have a voice in that historic choice. We have many people to thank tonight for making this event happen. First of all, the University of Winnipeg and Richardson College for providing the venue and for the stage and the sound. Keith Bellamy's here tonight, and he did a great job working with us for that. Also want to thank several organizations that provided funding for tonight. The Global Political Economy Program at the University of Manitoba, as well as the Department of Native Studies at the University of Manitoba, and Masters of Development Practice and Indigenous Development Program here at the University of Winnipeg all contributed generously. We have several sponsoring organizations, including Climate Change Connection, Manitoba Eco Network, the Green Action Committee of the First Unitarian Church, Council of Canadians, and Green Action Center, and the University of Winnipeg Sustainability Office all helped out with logistics and organizing and staff time. And many of these groups have information at the tables at the side, and I really encourage you to check it out after we're done today. Also to sign up if you want to stay involved with this movement, because I think really tonight's the start of building a movement of people that are concerned about these issues here in Manitoba. There were dozens of people, literally dozens of people involved in the preparation and planning for tonight's event. And I've only got time to mention a few. I just want to mention Liz Williams, Annie Tertin, Alain Weinberg, Jonathan Ventura, and Alana Lejoie O'Malley, because they each put in many hours of time to make sure that this night's a success. One other organization that I do want to thank tonight is CGOB. They provided our moderator, Richard Cloutier. Richard hosts a morning news show on CGOB 68 AM. and I'm always impressed by his ability to fairly present complicated and often controversial issues in a really listenable way. And so I'm really looking forward to his moderation tonight, and really grateful that he was able to help us here tonight. The schedule will be fairly simple. We're going to have an opening welcome from Louis Young of the Blood Vein First Nation. Then we'll watch a short film to introduce us to the region and some of the issues around the pipeline. And after that, we'll move directly into our panelists, and we've scheduled half an hour for presentations afterwards. Then at the end, there will be time to mingle and discuss amongst ourselves, because as interesting and as important as the panelists are today, I really think that it's important for us to all have our voices heard on this issue. Now I'd like to introduce Louis Young. He's an elder, a traditional teacher, and a former chief with the Blood Vein First Nation, and he will give us a welcome to his traditional territory. Louis.
Thank you, Josh. Migwashkatin in the Mabi Jayak Manum, Epidishintamik Imamakinan. I want to say thank you to all of you for coming here today to come and talk about our Mother Earth. I was on checking messages on Facebook, and my phone was vibrating, and Suzanne was on Facebook and Alon was on my phone, both of them trying to contact me to come and participate here this evening. So I don't know which one of them won. If they want to claim who brought me here, they'll have to draw. They told me about some of the speakers that are going to be here, and I thought I should look them up and read a little bit about them. And so I looked in the internet, and I found Anne Lindsay, and I thought, that can't be her. I'm not sure. She's a musician, plays the violin, played in some movies. I don't know, maybe that's not her. So I didn't read up on that one. I thought I might speak about the wrong Lindsay. And then Lynne Fernandez, I couldn't find her either. But I learned a little bit about them when I got here. Anne Lindsay is a former executive director of Equal Network, and she's worked on nuclear waste issues in the east side of Lake Winnipeg, or I guess Canada, I guess. And Lynne Fernandez, Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives. And then I looked up Gerald Amos. Was Chief Councillor of Kitimat Village, British Columbia, for 12 years. He was a founding member of Equal Trust Canada, former member of Human Rights Advisory Commission, and so much more. And I believe he is currently Chief Negotiator for, pardon my pronunciation, Haisla Treaty Negotiation Team, or something like that. I was really impressed with what I saw about you on the internet. And then I looked up Wade Davies, and I could have spent hours watching that video I found there. Really impressed anthropologist, grew up in Montreal, and learned to love studying culture and people. And I really loved what he said there about traveling the world, because it gives you an opportunity to live amongst people who have not forgotten the old ways. As an anthropologist looking at the many cultures around the world, he says that all these people teach us that there are other ways of being, thinking, and orienting ourselves in social and spiritual ecological space, and that's an idea that can only fill us with hope. And that's what I talk a lot about today, is hope. There's so much demoralization, there's so much lack of hope in many of our people, especially amongst our native youth. And I say, our native youth, they know so much because they have access to so much information. The problem is they can't organize it. And so it's confusing and frustrating for them. When you talk to our people individually, one-on-one, they are very much environmentalists. When they're out there in the world struggling, their only thought during the day is survival, surviving from one day to the next. I also took the time to take a quote from a former astronaut, Edgar Mitchell. And what's he got to do with environmentalism? Edgar Mitchell was an astronaut in the Apollo space program, Apollo 14. He was the sixth man to walk on the moon. And on his trip back from the moon, while looking out the portholes of the space module, he said he was suddenly seized by a moment of ecstasy of unity, where he sensed that the universe was not random or accidental, but an intellectual process at work, and in some way conscious and interconnected through every atom of its being. That is so much the concept of traditional Native people in North America, that the universe is alive, that the earth is alive, that we are all interconnected. I thought I'd bring that to you today to lead into the prayer that I want to offer so that the process here today comes up with positive results. And I want to say that I'm going to say my prayer in the Ojibwe language, and that don't worry about understanding what I'm praying about, because I'm not talking to you anyway. Alan offered me some tobacco, which is one of the things that we do when we ask somebody to say prayers, we give tobacco. And I must say that I don't know if all of you received the card, the sports card that Alon is passing around. Alon needs to be congratulated. His first baby was born 13 days ago. So. Great Spirit, I want to ask for direction and guidance this evening for these talks that are going to happen, that we are guided by the loving spirit of the Creator, that the things that are talked about are going to result in positive things for people and for animals and for the plant life, for our Mother Earth. I ask that those things happen this evening. Miigwech.
Thank you very much, Louis. On the slideshow next to us, we've been seeing pictures of the area where the pipeline is going into in northwestern BC, and the photos come from Wade Davis's book that he'll probably be mentioning a little bit more about during his talk. But before we get into the discussion, we've heard a lot from people coming in that, you know, where is this? They don't really know the geography that well. And we thought it would be helpful to introduce the night tonight with a short film presentation. It's a film that's produced by a group in BC called Pacific Wild. And the film is called Oil in Eden. And we'll just watch that shortly right now. It's about a 15-minute film, and then we'll move on to the speakers right away.
It's one of the last great wild places on the planet, the north and central Pacific coast of Canada. Alternately known as the Great Bear Rainforest, it's the largest intact temperate rainforest on Earth.
Coastal British Columbia virgin rainforests, wild fish, wild places. This is what the world is looking at.
There's nothing like living this type of lifestyle that we've had for thousands of years. We have fresh air, we have fresh water. We're a rich people. We're rich from the bounty of the sea.
It's a place of roaming wild wolves, majestic grizzlies and mythical spirit bears, wild salmon, orca, and one of the ocean's most magnificent creatures, humpback whales, which have miraculously returned to this coast in record numbers over the past decade. But these whales, fish, and wildlife, and the indigenous and coastal communities that depend on them, now find their very survival threatened by a proposal from energy giant Enbridge to bring an oil pipeline and supertankers to these fragile and dangerous coastal waters. The plan is to pump over 500,000 barrels a day of unrefined bitumen from the Alberta tar sands over the Rocky Mountains and across the heartland of BC to the port of Kitimat. From there, some of the world's largest oil tankers would set sail along BC's rugged coast through the Great Bear Rainforest on their way to China and the United States. Dubbed the Northern Gateway Pipeline, the 1,100-kilometer, $6 billion project is of concern to opponents for three main reasons. One, the risks from the pipeline itself, which would cross over 1,000 rivers and streams. Two, the dangers of introducing oil supertankers for the first time to this part of the wild BC coast. And three, the fact the project would facilitate the rapid expansion of the tar sands, hooking emerging Asian economies on the world's dirtiest oil.
This is a Canadian project that is changing the Canadian experience, that is changing our politics, that's changing our economics, that's changing our international reputation abroad, that is changing everything we thought we knew about this country.
How are we going to tell other countries that they should be reducing fossil fuel consumption if we go forward and build this pipeline?
Now, a broad coalition of citizens and concerned organizations from Canada and around the world are joining forces to halt this contentious proposal from Enbridge, the world's biggest oil pipeline construction company.
Whatever it takes. I mean, we're and our position right now is this project's not going to happen.
Clearly, Canada is at a crossroads. The country must now decide whether to allow the expansion of the tar sands with this pipeline, or heed the growing calls from around the world to change course, keeping this wild coast wild and oil-free. Given the stakes, the pipeline issue is shaping up to be the defining Canadian environmental battle of our time. At a recent press conference in Vancouver, chosen for the anniversary of the disastrous Exxon Valdez oil spill, an unprecedented alliance of Indigenous people, local and international conservation groups, and high-profile figures announced a unified declaration against the Enbridge proposal.
They told us, and they said this at their AGM as well, that if all of the communities within this geographic region didn't support the pipeline, that they would stop the project. We are here to tell you today that all of the communities are opposed to Enbridge.
Today, we're putting Enbridge on notice, we're putting governments on notice, and we're putting ourselves on notice that from here on out, when it comes to our culture, which comes from our relationship to the land, we are going to be firm.
Following the historic declaration, several of these coastal First Nations hosted a large feast on the traditional territory of the Haisla people near the town of Kitimat, the location of the proposed tanker terminal. The feast saw over 1,000 people from the territory and around BC share their cultures, their friendship, and their joint convictions to stop the pipeline and tankers. BC's coastal First Nations are unanimously opposed to the pipeline and tanker proposal. While polls show that 80% of British Columbians support banning crude oil tankers on the province's coast,
It's not a matter of if, but when a major oil spill would happen if they went forward with this proposal. That'll impact salmon and bears and just the incredible wildlife diversity that is found there. Not to mention, of course, First Nations communities that rely on the ocean for their survival.
Among the many marine species threatened by tankers are the whale populations that inhabit these waters in abundance. Orca, fin, and humpback whales, amongst other cetaceans, face threats not just from an oil spill, but from ship strikes, as in this fin whale hit by a cruise ship on the same coastline last year, and the submarine noise pollution from tankers, in excess of 100 decibels, that impacts whales' vital acoustic sensibilities. This very part of the coast proposed for tanker traffic has been designated by the Federal Department of Fisheries and Oceans as critical habitat for humpbacks, recognized as a species at risk. Herman Muter is a whale researcher whose team at the Cutting Edge Cetacea Lab has been studying whales on the coast for the past decade.
We now have about 185 resident humpback whales which is rising from about 20 to 30 in 2002. And one reason why we think the humpbacks do sing here so much is because these waters here, including Whale Channel, Squally Channel, Wright Sound, Kamana Sound, are for the most part quite underwater worlds. If Enbridge gets approved with their Gateway Pipeline project, and we have these super tankers coming here, where super tankers are the loudest vessels underwater, and I think we are going to lose this quiet underwater world where the whales still can sing, and I think the whales are not going to continue to sing. They will just stop. They will even perhaps move on and just disappear from this area altogether.
These waters are teeming with other important marine life too, including diverse marine mammals, salmon, halibut, various rockfish, shellfish, herring, ulukin, birds, and many other species, which would all be gravely threatened by oil tankers. The iconic land mammals of the coast are also in jeopardy, most notably the famous spirit bear, a unique black bear with white fur. In actual numbers, as rare as the panda, this extraordinary creature can only be found in the Great Bear Rainforest, directly in the path of the proposed oil tankers. These ecological concerns are compounded by the likelihood of a spill, given that the proposed tanker route out Douglas Channel and along the BC North and Central Coast is fraught with navigational hazards. These enormous ships would need to travel at speeds in excess of 15 knots through treacherous reefs and rocks, fast-moving currents, and frequent gale and even hurricane-force winds, year-round, regardless of conditions. These waters continue to be the site of shipping disasters. Several years ago, a passenger ferry, the Queen of the North, sank here and is still sitting on the ocean floor, leaching fuel into the marine environment.
The waters of the Pacific, they're not calm every day of the year. The weather system has changed so much that we get more southeast storms than we've ever had.
The oil these tankers would carry is of serious environmental concern in and of itself. The extraction, refining, and production of tar sands bitumen, a viscous substance that needs to be mixed with natural gas condensate just to make it flow, produce far higher climate change causing carbon emissions than conventional oil. As leading tar sands expert and author Andrew Nikiforuk told a recent gathering of citizens in Vancouver.
The National Energy Technology Lab recently looked at this, and they looked at domestic crude in the United States, and they said, okay, what are the carbon emissions when we're making diesel fuel from and using crude from different sources? And they found that the stuff with the highest footprint, bar none, was the stuff from Venezuela and Canadian bitumen. 244% more carbon.
The source of this bitumen is the single largest and most polluting industrial project on the planet, the Alberta tar sands. In addition to their enormous carbon emissions, these tar sands projects spread throughout the Peace River and Athabasca basins are contaminating watersheds and ecosystems, which fish and wildlife and Indigenous communities depend upon for their survival. We offered Enbridge numerous opportunities to comment for this film, but the company denied our requests. However, the Enbridge president in charge of the pipeline project, John Carruthers, has been outspoken of late about the benefits of the project. This recent op-ed piece by Carruthers was in response to the federal opposition leader's vow to impose a moratorium on oil tankers on BC's north coast, a major political blow to Enbridge's proposal. In response, Carruthers tried to downplay the project's risks while selling its economic benefits. But the truth is, the people of BC would receive very little economic benefit from the Enbridge project, compared with the enormous risks to the environment, to First Nations, and communities spanning the pipeline an entire length of BC's coast. The province is simply a necessary pass-through point for the pipeline, or, as some have charged, a doormat. After the three-year construction phase, few long-term jobs would remain, and many of the construction workers would be imported from outside of local communities and the province. Weighed against the potential consequences of the project, the economic benefits simply don't add up.
Opposing is something that's not really part of a business culture. What bothers me about this pipeline issue is looked at from all sides, up, down, any way you can. There is no way forward. That opposition is the only viable thing you can do. It is a very simple equation. The pipeline exists, and sooner or later, we will not.
Enbridge critics in BC needn't point further than their northern neighbor to remind people of the ecological and economic risks of oil tanker traffic. Years after the disastrous Exxon Valdez spill in Alaska, entire fish and wildlife populations and coastal communities have yet to recover. What's more, the navigation route of the Valdez through Prince William Sound was far less dangerous than the proposed Enbridge tanker route. By superimposing the impact area of the Exxon spill over BC's coast, one begins to get a sense of just what's at stake here. Its 2,200 kilometer length would cover virtually the entire BC coast.
If we had a tanker accident on the coast of British Columbia, it would literally wipe out all of our cultures, all of our salmon, all of our ground fish and halibut and cod and everything else. We cannot allow this to happen.
We're over 20 years since the Exxon Valdez disaster in Alaska, and they're still analyzing the impact. They're still finding crude oil in the beaches. The orca whales still have not returned, and economies and communities have been devastated by it.
The recent catastrophe still unfolding in the Gulf of Mexico from the blowout of BP's Deepwater Horizon oil well has also provided a potent reminder of the risks of introducing oil to sensitive coastlines. And Enbridge itself has given British Columbians even more cause for concern, following their own recent disaster in Michigan, where the company's pipeline spilled close to 4 million liters of oil, contaminating the Kalamazoo River and nearby residential community of Battle Creek. Adding insult to injury, the same company has had two other major pipeline leaks since then, in Illinois and near Buffalo, New York. The west coast of Canada is no stranger to environmental battles, but nothing so far compares to what's coming down the pipeline now. The resistance to the Enbridge proposal, led first and foremost by First Nations, is growing stronger by the day.
Enbridge had come into Hartney Bay and had a meeting there. You could feel when you're being patronized, you know, a little isolated community of 160 people. And so I told him, what you see here is not what you get. We're a clan system, we're First Nations, we have relatives all up and down this coast, and we're all coastal people and we depend on the sea. And whatever help we need, they're going to be there.
Everything is at stake here in this battle over the pipeline in BC's coast. Our international reputation, our constitution that protects Aboriginal title and rights, the democratic voice of the majority of British Columbians, and the last bastions of Canadian wilderness. What's at risk here is nothing short of one of the most spectacular places on Earth. As awareness of the plan builds, expect this issue to become a defining battle between big oil and a growing grassroots network.
Canada could step in now and say, this isn't the future. This is not our future. This is not what we want for our children or for our country or for the planet, and put a stop to this.
Will the oil industry once again be allowed to trample over the public and environmental interest? Or will people power prove this scheme to be only a pipe dream?
Hello, everyone. Please hold your applause. But welcome our four panelists, please, to the... I noticed that we are in a beautiful new building, but we're in the Power Corporation atrium, folks. Dr. Wade Davis is here, Ann Lindsay, Lynne Fernandez, and Gerald Amos. And we'll have the presentations 10 to 15 minutes. My role here is to moderate. I don't think I'll need to stimulate with this crowd here. We'll have some time for some questions and some comments and some answers a little bit later on. I look at these, I'm passionate about the environment, but I'm also here to learn. And we have four very, very compelling speakers from near and afar with very important perspectives on this. Gerald Amos is a former elected Chief Councillor for the Haisla First Nation for 12 years. He's been a leading voice for conservation in Canada for 30 years, and he is author of an open letter to the Prime Minister Stephen Harper and Natural Resources Minister Joe Oliver. No apology forthcoming. Ladies and gentlemen, Gerald Amos.
Hey, Mas. Moose Majil. Isakatli. Wakas. Kusuik nog een hamzak aan wie een hout kus guukes is. Ladies and gentlemen, that was a welcome and a thank you that was used in the feast hall and continues to be used in the feast hall of the Haisla people and our brothers and sisters up and down the coast of British Columbia. And it basically says, chiefs, ladies, our neighbors, and the rest of you, thank you for hosting us. And it's not good enough for us to simply eat and visit in your house. We need to acknowledge your hospitality. And with that, I want to thank my brother from the local First Nations community for welcoming us onto his territory. We appreciate it. I appreciate it. My time with you this evening, I'll spend in an attempt to introduce you to myself, to my family, to my community, and to the area that you just seen portrayed somewhat on this video. I was born in 1949 in a little community called Bella Bella on the coast of British Columbia. However, I live in Kitimat, which is now home to people who live in the town of Kitimat, a population of approximately 8,000 to 9,000 people now. And it's also home to a series of industrial development, including an aluminum smelter, a former pulp mill, a methanol plant, and of course the town. And this is all quite recent, it's in my lifetime. The reason I told you about my birthday, not to tell you how old I was, but I grew up with this. I grew up and matured watching this development take place. And I also witnessed as our resources that we relied on for forever began to diminish. The Kitimat River, where what we call Kachdalisla, has been described as a dinner plate of the Haisla people. Everything that is required to sustain that community of ours was right there in front of us. And up until 1972, the ulakan, which is a smelt like fish, was rendered into ulakan oil and traded up and down the coast and into the interior of the province for foodstuff that we didn't get locally. Up until 1972, that little fish was the most important food for the Haisla people, up until 1972. And in the blink of an eye, it was gone. And with it, the nutrition that kept our people healthy through the winter months and whatnot. At the same time, out on the coast, DFO in its wisdom allowed a fishery on the abalone to commercialize it. And in the space of 15 years, that abalone disappeared to a point where there was no harvest allowed, including for our own use. So the abalone was a critical part of the people that Helen Clifton represented in this video. And by the way, I've committed to opposing this project for many reasons, but including standing in front of a bulldozer. But I think the real person that the company and government need to be concerned about is Helen Clifton. She's the real power behind this movement in the community of Hartley Bay, and in fact in our whole region. So this abalone issue and whatnot, you know, we know now what those mistakes were. The abalone is a spatial creature. It needs a certain density of population to be able to reproduce. We took that away. We allowed it to disappear. And I don't know if in my lifetime we'll be able to harvest for our own consumption again that abalone. As far as I'm concerned at this point in time, the ulakan is extinct in the five rivers that sustained them in the Haisla territory. They're extinct, they're gone. I don't believe they'll ever be a harvestable run of ulakan unless we get a great deal of resources to work on rehabilitating the rivers. And it's going to take millions and millions and millions of dollars, if not billion, because there's been a lot of damming. So I wanted to share that with you because I've often made this contended that as a thinking species, as smart as our species is, as understanding as we are of how to the innovation that we've created in our lifetime, we don't learn very fast. We're very slow learners when it comes to recognizing the mistakes that our governments have made, including my own government, the people that I come from. We make the same mistakes. The difference is, I think, that the scale of mistakes that we're prepared to make right now are such that this issue that we're talking about is not simply about our region anymore. It's going to impact everybody, and it has the potential to do probably the final damage to the systems that have sustained us for generations. When I was a young boy, before I was even a man, 13 years old, I was on a commercial troller with my uncle. At 15, I was on a commercial seine boat. I don't know how many of you understand the terminology, but a seine boat is just you've seen it on there, harvesting salmon. And I was in that region. We fished in that area that where these whales are now returning in numbers. When I was there, it was very rare, if at all, we seen a humpback whale. In that whole area we fished in, commercial fish, what you seen there was a part of where we harvested salmon commercially. Never seen them. And in the short space of part of my life, there's 180 of them there all of a sudden. I've seen up to 17 in one pod in that area feeding. So what I'm taking from that is that if we begin to make the right decisions and we keep some of these places like what we're talking about here as pristine as we possibly can, we have a hope. There is the opportunity to make the right decisions so that the earth can begin to take care of itself. David Suzuki is fond of saying that, you know, when we talk about our management of salmon, when we talk about managing the forests, he said, how arrogant is that? He said, if you leave the salmon and these rivers alone and you keep them as healthy as you can, they'll look after themselves just fine. They don't need us. No, there's you know, it's the over-harvesting and the big developments that have really done the damage. And the fact that we've got these creatures returning, I think signifies that when we make the right decisions and we leave these places intact, the system will look after itself. I think it's proven with, like, the human body. We know what causes diabetes. We know what causes obesity. We know what causes heart problems. And when we treat our body with respect, it pretty much looks after itself. And the earth is the same way. So we're a community, not just the Haisla, but the communities in general up in our area. I like to think that our communities were a very industrious society. I learned recently, for instance, that an oil called garum, and I only learned this because I was around smart people. Garum was produced by the Romans, like way the hell back, made out of fermented fish guts. And very similar to the process that our people employed to make ulucan oil. It was the ulucans were allowed to rot, and then the oil is easier to get out of it. So my friend who researched this told me that 1,500 years before the Romans started making garum, the Haisla people and others on the coast were making ulucan oil. So our people were ahead of the Romans, I like to think. And when it comes to recent developments, if you look at the sites that had the letter that we published, that we sent out with respect to this apology, not apologizing for seeking assistance, you'll find comments that are quite derogatory toward our people. And it's suggesting that we need to get jobs, that we need to get off welfare, that we need to become productive members of society. Well, you know, in my case, I've been working since I was 13. Assistance, as it's known, I think in most communities, didn't happen till 1966. Government assistance, social assistance, it didn't take place till 1966 in our community. And, you know, I only point this out to say that, you know, there are people who haven't paid attention. They're not taking the time to understand what is really motivating me and the people that you've seen speaking about their concerns. They're not being very patient. They're not being very respectful, and that's fine. I mean, I'm not gonna lose sleep over it, but I am concerned that it could, if we allow it, allow the government to take a really right-wing approach to these kind of issues and use those that discontent to work in opposition to what we want. And I think that now, in this country called Canada, we're so proud of the as a country and as a people, I think that the simple question that I've heard repeated, and I said this in a couple of places today, if we can't get this straight in Canada, if we can't come to agreements with between First Nations government, provincial and federal governments, and the communities that are in our territory now, where else on earth do we have a chance of making some decisions that we can be proud of? And that's my challenge to myself, and my challenge to people who care to listen to us, who care to work with us. You know, we need to join hands. We need to work to ensure that our children. I was showing Wade and my new friends here a picture I took of my youngest grandbaby. And I didn't know it at the time, but she was standing in front of me with the sun behind me, and she's in my saddle. Like, she's standing as a 2.5-year-old baby, standing with the sun behind me, and my saddle is on top of her. And when I first seen that, I realized what I was looking at. It was like a moment, like, holy crap, you know, this, it was so symbolic to me. You know, we have our grandchildren standing in our saddle, and I want that little girl to look back and say, well, he was part of making the right decision. I hope. And I think that's what we're striving for, is to bring people together to have a conversation about what kind of a Canada, what kind of a coast do we want to live in. And there are some special places, and I think this is one of them, that deserves to be protected. Because it's not just going to impact, that decision is going to have far-reaching implications, not just because of the pristineness of the place, but because the policies that we allow to govern our lives is such today that our voices are really not being heard. I know I'm running out of time here, but I wanted to leave this with you. Our community, for a period of 6 years now, on this particular project called Enbridge, our leadership have been writing letters to the National Energy Board, the Canadian Environmental Assessment Authority, and to the government. And what we've been after as a community is a proper consultation and a proper accommodation of our community's requirements. And what they've, I think what most people will find when they start digging into this, governments want to provide an economic interest in these projects, to rope us into it. And to us, accommodation is more than simply making money off these projects. It's about the proper design of the joint review process, the proper design of the permitting structure that allows these projects to go ahead. And right now, you know, we've determined a long time ago, many years ago, that the current system is not designed to allow communities to make their own decisions or to be part of the decision making. They'll hear our voice, they'll hear Helen and I speak, but at the end of the day, it's designed to simply push these projects through. And that's really what our community has been up to, is an attempt to work with government to get them to appreciate that accommodation isn't just about money. It's about addressing the other values that we hold dear to us. And I'm hoping that with the help of good people, and I'm hoping that many of you will look at this as an opportunity to make your voices heard, because I think that we have an opportunity to, as my friend Cecil Paul in Kitimat, one of our elders, says, we've got this canoe that we've built, and it's a magic one. Every person that wants to join us, this canoe gets bigger and bigger. So if you want to join the canoe, there's information in the back, and you know, we're available to have a conversation anytime. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lynne Fernandez is here. She's with the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives. Lynne has an MA in economics from the University of Manitoba and is a research associate at the Manitoba office for the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives. Lynne has had the opportunity to research both municipal and provincial social and economic policy. She's also interested in labor and in environmental issues. Lynne is an expat Albertan who was born and raised in Calgary. And it says here she likes living in Winnipeg. I would attest she loves living in Winnipeg. Here's Lynne.
Thank you very much, Richard, and thank you very much, Louis, for your blessings this evening. I hope they have the intended effect. And everybody, this is take a deep breath because we're going to talk about a little bit of economic stuff. And if you could advance, please. Thanks. Tonight I want to look a little bit at what the industry claims are around the economic issues because of course the whole rationale for going ahead with the tar sands and for this particular project are economic and the economic benefits not just to Alberta but to Canada as a whole. And then I want to take a look at an independent evaluation of the Northern Gateway Pipeline proposal, and so we can get a contrast of what the industry says and what somebody who's perhaps a little more arm's length would say, please. This first slide is showing you information from the Canadian Energy Research Institute, which claims to be a research institute that is impartial and objective and has on its board people from federal and provincial government, from academia, which seems to be one guy from the University of Calgary, and of course members from the oil and gas industry, particularly Imperial Oil and Nexon. So I do question really how objective it is. But this organization does economic research, and it looked at three case scenarios, and I'm showing you the third one, which is looking at the economic impact of existing pipelines and adding on top of that the Trans-Canada Keystone XL pipeline, which we've heard so much about from the States, and then the Northern Gateway pipeline. And according to this institute, these three case scenarios combined together, over the 2010 and 2020 period, they have an estimated investments and reinvestments and revenues from operation of oil, what they call oil sands, we call tar sands, which will add up to over $1 trillion in that 10-year period. So that's $100 billion, more than that, and that's actually getting close to the amount of Canadian GDP. And they also claim that the investment shocks, what they call investment shocks, to Canadian GDP, once again will be over $1 trillion in this 10-year period. Employee compensation, $342 billion. They claim that jobs by 2020 will go up to 800,000 in Canada. And Alberta royalties paid by the oil industry to Alberta will go from $3.56 billion to $26 billion by 2020. And the other thing that I think is really interesting, if you look at the last three points, this report also shows what the economic impact is going to be for the United States. It's something I didn't really expect to see from a Canadian website. I mean, really, is it that significant? Well, it turns out that it is. And as you can see, for example, there's $138 billion worth of economic impact in the United States. And U.S. employment will go from 80,000 jobs to 200,000 jobs by 2020. So this contention that we've been hearing that actually the tar sands and the oil industry in Alberta does more, just almost as much to export jobs and stimulate economies in a foreign country is actually true, even by the industry's own admission. It's also important to point out that according to the analysis that I'm going to get to in a moment, the estimated investment and reinvestment generated by this particular project, by the Northern Gateway project, do not represent, I repeat, an increase in the productive capacity of the Canadian economy. This project will simply redirect existing supply. It's not going to actually increase production. So I'm going to turn to this report that just came out. It was done by a BC economist named Robin Allen, and she presented this report to the National Energy Board Joint Review Panel as evidence. And they tried not to let her present it, actually. She put her name down to present, and they wouldn't let her. But she managed to present because the Alberta Federation of Labour had a spot to present, so they let her present on their behalf. And I'm going to hit some of the highlights of her report. I know I have a very short period of time. It's a very in-depth, complicated report, and there's just no way I can do it justice. But do keep in mind that she's very critical of the simple assumptions that are made about price, economic conditions, and exchange rates. And the report that she's critiquing was done by Enbridge, but it was done by some consultants that Enbridge hired to do an economic analysis for them. So they really chose a lot of best case scenario assumptions throughout their analysis, and she's quite critical of that. Please. So the claims made by Enbridge are that between 2013 and 2046, the report that Enbridge uses concludes that the project will create GDP growth of $270 billion and labor income of $48 billion. And that there will be government revenues of $81 billion. So this is something that the industry is very careful to highlight all the time, how much tax that they're going to be paying and how much revenue is going to be going into government coffers, not just provincial but also federal. And Robin Allen is very critical, because the report really looks at what all the economic additions are going to be, what the benefits are going to be, but it doesn't take into consideration any externalities. And externalities, of course, as most of you will know, will be the cost to the environment, the social costs, the costs that society has to bear but that the industry is not going to be responsible for. And if you're going to do a fair economic analysis, of course, you have to consider what these externalities are. If you look at that red part there, she claims that Enbridge is allowed to use the economic gains from potential, and potential, it has to be emphasized, future production to make its public interest case to the Joint Review Panel, while the environmental costs that arise from this same projected production are explicitly excluded from being brought to bear on the discussion. So even without the externalities, and what Robin Allen did is says, okay, fine, let's not talk about externalities. You guys are talking about what an economic boon this is going to be. I'm going to evaluate your assessment strictly on economic terms. I'm just going to do a straight-up neoclassical analysis here. I'm not going to take into effect the cost of the environment or the social costs. And even when she did that sort of an evaluation, she found that the Northern Gateway Pipeline will create little, if any, real benefit, and is more likely to have long-term negative economic consequences. Underlying assumptions. This is sort of the Achilles heel of economic modeling, because these models that they do, they have to make certain assumptions that they often are holding constant, and your analysis only ends up being as good as the assumptions that you're making. Allen refers to the assumption made in Enbridge's analysis of the exchange rate, for example, over time as being faulty. They assume an 85-cent Canadian dollar, and you know, over the last 3 years or 2 years, we certainly have seen that that's not the case. And she says it could just as easily be a 95-cent Canadian dollar or even at par. And as soon as you make that sort of a change, it kind of blows their projections out of the water. And she says it could represent actually an economic cost to the Canadian oil and gas industry. Her overall conclusion is that Northern Gateway threatens the long-term stability of the Canadian economy and negatively impacts the standard of living for most Canadians. And she says even emphasizing that excluding the broader environmental concerns of a full accounting framework, the Northern Gateway project is just not in the public interest of Canada. So let's look at some of the reasons that she says this. There's a bit of an overview of the problems that she feels are not dealt with in Enbridge's analysis. The first one is price increases. We will have to pay $2 to $3 more per barrel of crude oil for the next 30 years. And she claims, and I think we'll see that she's probably right, that this price increase is solely attributable to the new pipeline. In fact, Allen claims that the actual purpose of the Northern Gateway Pipeline project is to increase the price of crude oil for all Canadian consumers. And this is significant, as I'll explain. This is how the price increase works. Right now, there's already an excess of crude oil production coming out of Western Canada. It's kind of bizarre because we're exporting so much of it down to the States when Eastern Canada has to import foreign oil, but that's another issue. A lot of the oil is being exported to the U.S. Midwest, and that's causing a glut of crude oil. And as we know, when there's an excess supply, the price is going to come down. So it lowers the price on the benchmark West Texas Intermediate, which is the pricing mechanism for crude in North America. Canadian producers, of course, don't necessarily like low prices. If they can get higher prices, they'll definitely go for it. So they sort of scan the global economy and they say, is there anybody out there who would actually pay more for our crude? And if so, we'll restrict how much is sold in Canada, and we'll restrict how much is exported to the U.S., and we'll sell where the supply is lower and the demand is greater. So, of course, when they do this scan to see where this market might be, it turns out that it's in Northeast Asia. And they're on a different pricing mechanism, they're in a different market, and so Northeastern prices are set differently, and they pay what's called an Asian premium on their crude. So the Northern Gateway, they hope, will piggyback on this premium, and that's why they're looking to get that oil into BC so they can get it into the Northeast Asian market. And this is a quote from her report, that Canadians will find themselves pushed into an international demand curve that accepts higher prices, and higher prices that then we as Canadians will have to deal with. There's some debate about whether this Asian premium actually exists, and whether it will continue, especially if Canada starts providing oil to China, and they might actually sort of ruin that Asian premium as China's options for buying oil sort of expand. The ability to discriminate based on pricing will deteriorate, and there's actually a good chance that this price premium will disappear once Canada starts exporting to China. So if Enbridge can't capture this higher price for its crude oil, there will actually be no net benefit to the oil and gas sector, and there will be no economic case for going ahead with Northern Gateway. But what's important to remember is that without an inflationary increase in oil prices, Enbridge's claims as to the benefits of the project disappear. Nonetheless, Enbridge is proceeding as if this price premium is real and will last. If this is a quote from this president of Liquid Pipelines for Enbridge, and as you can say, he says that the victim is price. And that is what the Northern Gateway Pipeline is all about. It's not about whether you can move the barrels to the U.S., but the price punishment that takes place when you have no other market available. So Enbridge is admitting that the reason for going ahead with the Northern Gateway project is so that they can have access to this different market. And the dynamics of the oil market mean that those higher prices will be passed on to Canadians. Assuming that Enbridge's analysis is correct, and Robin Allen is not so sure that it is, but even assuming that it is, and they're able to capture this higher price premium, inflation will follow. And all the list of nasty things follows when you have inflation, and there'll be a decrease in purchasing power, which is something that's been decreasing over the last 30 or 40 years anyway. We'll see a decline in real GDP, decline in government revenues, et cetera, et cetera. The other thing that happens, likely will happen, will be there'll be an appreciation of the Canadian dollar. And that leads to a thing called Dutch disease, and the definition of which is a decline in exports of manufacturing goods caused by a resource export boom. And the export boom causes an appreciation of domestic currency because there's more and more domestic currency coming into Canada to purchase our oil. That leads to inflation and lower levels of income growth and rising unemployment in the non-resource sector. So it's the influx of foreign exchange that causes Dutch disease, and it can have a devastating effect on the economy, as it did in Holland with North Sea oil, which is where this phenomenon was first identified. This graph is from Ellen's report, and there is a debate about whether we have Dutch disease in Canada, if the high Canadian dollar is indeed caused by the oil industry. But we do see here in this graph a definite correlation between the price of oil and the exchange rate. And I also think that if it were just caused by the devaluation of the American dollar because of the recession, because our economy is so tied to the American economy, why is our Canadian dollar not being brought down with the American dollar? Because people perceive our economy as being so tied to it. So I think there is something going on here that's keeping our dollar high, other than the fact that we came through the recession better than they did. Once again, from Ellen's report to the National Energy Board, this development of a natural resource like this that leads to Dutch disease, which affects the entire country and causes our manufacturing sector to be less productive, leads to regional disparities. The fact that a rapidly appreciated dollar dramatically reduces the breadth and resiliency of the business sector makes our economy dependent on high commodity prices and exacerbates regional disparities. There's another report from Desjardins in 2006 that talks about the sort of vagaries of Dutch disease and questions the wisdom of exploiting the tar sands. And at the bottom there you can see that they are concerned that deep down there are regional and sectoral disparities which occur from having a high Canadian dollar. What happens is that kind of takes us back to being drawers of water and hewers of wood, which has always been a criticism of the Canadian economy, that we don't have a sophisticated manufacturing sector. And the Northern Gateway Pipeline will ensure that the Canadian economy moves further away from a diversified manufacturing sort of economy, and we remain that, keep that more sort of primitive drawer of resources that doesn't create forward and backward linkages and create high quality jobs. Just quickly, I wanted to take a look at how important the oil and gas sector is in the Canadian economy, because it seems to be such an important force, and it certainly is in Alberta. It's the main driver in Alberta. But it's actually 11th down here. I don't know if you can read that, but it's 11th down here in terms of percentage of GDP by sector. And that's even combining it with the mining sector as well. So by far, the most important sector is the finance and real estate, et cetera, and then after that is manufacturing. So when you put that in perspective, you can see it really carries a lot of weight in terms of policy, et cetera, but it's not really that important in the Canadian economy overall. Nonetheless, it gets a lot of tax incentives, something that the report doesn't talk about, and certainly something that people in Alberta don't talk about very much, is how much money they actually get in subsidies from governments. According to these two reports, it's up to almost $2 billion a year in subsidies. So they don't just pay into revenues, they get money back. you've probably all heard the old argument that the West wants in. This is something that came out of Alberta, complaining about it having such economic clout, but not having political clout in Canada. I would argue that the oil and gas sector is giving Alberta a lot of political power that is growing, and that its free market ideology is shaping policy on the national stage. For example, look at Harper's strong support of resource extraction as an economic strategy or nation building. The next slide will show you that Alberta's revenue, 28% of its revenue comes from the oil and gas industry, and then they use beggar thy neighbor policies for the rest of Canada, telling us that we have to keep our taxes down in order to be competitive with them. The problem is that a province like Manitoba can't get 28% of its revenues from oil and gas, and so it really does create a lot of political and economic disparity right even here in Western Canada as well. What happens because of the power that the oil industry has is that we have no strategic oil reserves in Canada. We are the only country in the 27-member International Energy Agency without a national strategy for security, energy security. And Canada is actually the most energy insecure member of that organization. And we have to remember that U.S. corporations control up to half of Alberta's oil. NAFTA, you probably have all heard of the proportionality clause. We cannot even limit exports, even in the case of a national emergency. We have to continue exporting proportionately the same amount to the United States as we produce ourselves. That's enshrined in NAFTA, and we can't change that. We have to continue exporting to the United States. So where does that leave us? The oil and gas sector, I would argue, distorts the importance of Alberta. The oil and gas sector puts our economy at risk rather than giving us security. It creates regional disparities. It doesn't allow us to nation build at all. It's actually sort of destroying the nation. And it puts our energy security at risk. And finally, if we carry that into the tar sands, as the largest hydrocarbon reserve in the world, Alberta will continue wreaking havoc with pan-Canadian policy and economy. It will continue shipping value-added economic activity and jobs out of Canada. And the Chinese want a piece of the action. The Americans are going to want to protect their interests. So that's an interesting dynamic. I don't even know how to begin thinking about that. And I contend that what should actually be a national treasure is going to turn out to be a national curse. So. That's it. Thank you very much.
So if you see me creeping a little closer to you, that'll be kind of like time's up. Ann Lindsay is here, former executive director of the Manitoba Eco Network. Ann has worked and volunteered on various Manitoba and national issues such as nuclear waste, forestry, food, and pesticides. And since, I can't believe this, 1984, you started as a teenager, including numerous experiences with environmental reviews. Ann Lindsay, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Richard, and thanks everybody else. What about, is it time for a stretch? Yeah, okay, stand up and then sit down again. Okay. That's it, big one. Good. So, okay, my job on this panel is to talk about public involvement in the Northern Gateway debate and why it's become such a poster child for the rights of the public to participate in environmental decision making. I don't have a PowerPoint, so you'll have to bear with me. I'll try not to use too many big words, but I am going to start with a bit of an introduction to environmental review, for those of you who are not familiar with it, and I beg the indulgence of those of you who are. Okay, so since the 1980s approximately, most of the industrial projects in Canada have been subject, in fact legally obliged, to undergo some kind of formal review of their impacts on the environment and also their social and economic effects. And so there are laws for this at both the provincial and the federal level. It becomes a federal responsibility when there are areas of federal jurisdiction involved, and so things like interprovincial matters or endangered species habitat, that kind of thing. Federal EA, as they call it, EA, environmental assessment, falls under one of the most important environmental laws that we have in this country. It's an act called the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act, sometimes known as CEA. Okay, it was originally designed to make sure that development respects the environment and people. The biggest projects get the highest level of review, so that's by a panel. The panel is chosen, people chosen for their knowledge and expertise on a subject. They hear from the proponent, the people that want to do the project, so in this case would be Enbridge, and then they hear the views and contributions of the interested public, and then they recommend whether or not the project should go forward. In the case of this project, the Northern Gateway Pipeline, there are lots of environmental federal triggers, so it makes it a candidate for a CEA review. But it also involves another important body because Northern Gateway is a pipeline. So you've heard talk of the National Energy Board, or NEB. That is an independent federal agency that regulates the international and interprovincial aspects of oil, gas, and electric utility industries. So it also has a panel process with the same kind of procedure as the CEA panel. For the Enbridge Northern Gateway Pipeline project, the government chose to convene what it calls a joint review panel, and you've seen it here referred to as JRP. So this panel will carry out the environmental assessment under the National Energy Board. The government can do that because in 2010, when they were a minority government, the Conservatives were able to pass this omnibus budget bill, which in an unusual move for Canada, also affected various other parts of legislation, most notably Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. And why did they do that? Well, it was because they feel that environmental assessment sometimes slows down economic growth. Therefore, in their view, it was appropriate in a budget act. So anyway, one of the changes they made was to allow environmental assessment to be delegated to other agencies, like the National Energy Board or the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, for example, and neither of them have traditionally been known for their environmental expertise. So Enbridge then is officially applying for this thing called a Certificate of Public Convenience and Public Convenience and Necessity. They need that in order to build the pipeline. All of the documents and the information relating to this hearing, you can find them on the NEB's website. And Enbridge, of course, has a really big website itself where you can find out their point of view on this important issue. So there are interesting differences between an NEB and CEA, the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency, regarding the outcome of public hearings and panel reviews. A CEA panel only recommends a course of action to the Environment Minister. Then the Minister and the Cabinet make a decision whether or not a project should go forward. The NEB, however, is different. It's a regulator. It may decide that a project is in the public interest and inform Cabinet that they should get their certificate. Cabinet can then choose whether or not to go ahead. Or the NEB may decide that the project is not in the public interest, and in this case, a certificate would not be issued, unless, of course, the proponent successfully appeals that decision. So in other words, as NEB's legislation currently reads, it is it, not the government, that decides whether a project goes ahead. And according to the University of Alberta law professor Nigel Banks, the government would need to introduce new legislation if it wished to override a negative decision on the part of the NEB. Well, when I found out about this, I was surprised to start with, because I didn't know much about the NEB before. And even for a few minutes, I was kind of hopeful. I thought this actually bodes well for this process, because I thought the NEB couldn't possibly find this project to be in the public interest once it had heard from all the people who are participating. And surely, I thought, the government would not want to go to all the trouble of introducing new legislation to change a negative outcome. But then I learned that the NEB almost never decides against projects, and my hope was chastened somewhat. And the more I've learned about this process as it's gone along, and the more new legislation that the government has introduced, the more chastened I have become. However, one cannot be help but be struck by the sheer number of people that have decided to participate and signed up to speak to this panel. Over 4,000 people, in fact. So I think the NEB should be happy. On their website, we read, quote, "The NEB wants to hear from people with an interest in the project before making a decision about a company's proposal. And the process is designed so that decision makers are presented with the complete range of views required to make fully informed decisions in the public interest." So they want to hear from us. One would think, too, that the government would be really happy that so many Canadians are participating in the democratic process. Surely that is a healthy sign. But wait, the day before the opening of the hearings, the Honorable Joe Oliver, the Minister of Natural Resources, and that's who the NEB is also responsible to, by the way, published his now famous open letter to Canadians, the one that Josh mentioned at the beginning of this, in which one of the things he did was decry the stacking of public hearings with bodies. And I heard him in media interviews following that letter, making it very clear that governments or review panels just don't need to hear from more than one person if they all have the same point of view. So many of us were quite stunned at this seeming intrusion of this minister into the supposedly independent proceedings of the panel, especially given that crystal clear message from him that the government wants this pipeline approved, and quickly, because they believe it's in Canada's national interest to export this bitumen to China. And of course, that was the same letter with the intimation about environmentalists or others opposed to this project being radicals. The pro-pipeline, anti-environmentalist rhetoric continued and even revved up a little bit with the Prime Minister's visit to China. One intervener group at the hearings, EcoJustice, submitted a motion to the panel, asking them to declare their independence and to request the government to stop commenting on the proceedings while they were going on. The panel actually declined that motion, but assured EcoJustice in a letter that they will act on the evidence. So will they do so? It's anyone's guess, and there is a really wide range of opinion on the validity and legitimacy of the panel proceedings. Nathan Cullen is the MP whose constituency much of the pipeline and tanker traffic would pass through. He called the panel process a farce. However, he is going to make a presentation. The British Columbia group Pacific Wild, whose video you saw earlier, has declined to participate since the panel refused to expand its scope to consider a wide range of critical issues raised by First Nations and community groups. And these include increased impacts on greenhouse gas emissions, expansion of the tar sands, downstream impacts of burning increased fossil fuels, and so on. These are things that the panel does not want to consider within its scope. But perhaps the most egregious concern about the panel process is contained within some innocuous sounding words that are right in the whereas section of the agreement that set up the joint review panel. Quote, "The government of Canada will rely upon the consultation effort of the proponent," that's Enbridge, "and the joint panel process to the extent possible to assist in meeting the duty to consult." And you've heard that referred to a couple of times this evening by Gerald and so on. The duty to consult refers to the legal obligation of the government to meaningfully consult First Nations to assess the potential impacts on Aboriginal title and rights. That obligation stems from a body of case law over the last number of years in which the Supreme Court of Canada has upheld the rights of Aboriginal peoples under Section 35 of the Constitution. But BC First Nations have indicated, as you heard also from Gerald, that Enbridge's attempts to consult with them were inadequate, that their concerns have not been addressed by the government, and there is no process in place separate from the joint panel to deal with those concerns. Therefore, it seems likely, if not inevitable, that this issue will go to court regardless of the panel's pronouncements. Some First Nations have chosen not to participate in the review. Other Canadians might feel that participating legitimizes an inadequate process. Many feel that the fix is in and that based on the Prime Minister's very public pronouncements that the pipeline decision has already been made. Yet, in spite of all these shortcomings, 4,000 plus people have chosen to participate directly, either as so-called interveners or in less formal presentations to the panel. Many other Canadians are taking the opportunity to write letters to the panel to express their views. And some of these participants, by the way, are in favor of the project. However, the vast majority seem to oppose it. The government attempted to divert attention from all this opposition by accusing environmental groups of being enthralled to foreign agendas and money, and by threatening to review their charitable status, or even in the case of one Conservative MP proposing that they no longer be allowed to accept contributions from outside of Canada. So even in this chilling atmosphere, people are still taking the time and opportunity to participate and share their views in a public arena. Is it important? Some may say no, but I'll argue that it is. I think it's critical to use the tools that we do have, even though they are inadequate. We need to improve them. The process of environmental assessment in the public interest is under threat. The current government has signaled loud and clear that EA is a nuisance, that it gets in the way of Canada's economic development, that it takes too long, and that it needs to be streamlined. The 2010 budget amendments were a step in that direction. And more recently, various ministers, including the Prime Minister, have made many pointed remarks hinting at future reduction in scope and effectiveness of EA, including the rights of the public to participate in reviews. The Enbridge Northern Gateway Pipeline has galvanized the interest of Canadians, and rightfully so. But let's think that other industrial developments of Canada's natural resources are taking place daily right across the country, even in areas where they may not be strikingly beautiful and pristine wilderness. There's always that economic debate around how essential any of these developments are to the well-being of Canadians. But if we allow government to take a view that thorough environmental and social assessment and meaningful consultation are expendable, we'll never fully understand their impacts. We will have abdicated our commitments to sustainability and to our future generations, our children and grandchildren. So we need to let government know that Canadians care about strong environmental laws and that EA is vital for Canada's future. On Northern Gateway, whether or not we live along the pipeline route or on the BC coast, this is an issue for all Canadians. I think Lynne made that case very clearly with her economic discussion. Though the scope of the panel review may not agree, that proposed pipeline can't be separated from the bitumen or the expansion of the tar sands, nor from the economic impacts of the petrodollar, Canada's energy policy, or concerns about the vast quantities of water used and polluted by the tar sands. Moreover, it cannot be separated from the climate change that is impacting all of us. We all live in the environment, and the environmental movement belongs to us all. And I can't read what my next notes say. Even here on the prairies, we have a right and obligation to speak out and to be heard on this issue. And many of us also want to stand in solidarity with the First Nations against the continuing colonization that this development represents. Therefore, I urge all of you to write to the panel expressing your views. Clearly, though, writing to the panel is just one option that's available to us for action. As we mentioned earlier, the organizing committee for this event has prepared some materials to assist people in getting further involved. There are tables set up at the side, information, postcards, a sign-up sheet. It is really important to let your MP know how you feel, because at the end of the day, whether it takes new legislation or whatever, maybe invocation of the notwithstanding clause, the government will make their decision. So you can get contact information for MPs in the Prime Minister's office, also back there. And there are some upcoming events that we have that might be of interest, some film screenings, and an evening with Nathan Cullen, MP. People are welcome to get involved in any way, to write to the panel, to volunteer, donate, sign petitions, and connect with organizations and First Nations working on this issue. In the bigger picture, there are some really pressing political issues facing our country about how governments get elected and how they can then take advantage of that position to change fundamental things about our country, even if the majority of Canadians didn't vote for them. That discussion is going on right now as we speak, and all of us can get involved in it, no matter what our political persuasion or our point of view. And finally, I think it's fair to say there's no doubt that we're in this for the long haul. Anyone who's seriously considered the impacts of climate change knows that reducing our dependence on fossil fuels and transitioning to a more climate-friendly living is just paramount. Many options for involvement exist in this community. right here in Winnipeg, across the country, in fact. Anyway, in Winnipeg, they need your support and participation. And I just want to add that this event tonight would not take place without some of those environmental organizations that are out there working to get information out to Canadians. And one of them, the Manitoba Eco Network, where I used to work, was one of the victims, if you like, of this government's war on the environment, because they had their federal funding cut, as some of you may know. So whether your interest is in food and agriculture, transportation, waste reduction, energy efficiency, or just more humane ways of doing business, there are all kinds of groups out here, like co-ops, bicycle hubs, community gardens, food buying groups. They're abounding and thriving. Winnipeg is becoming a transition town, even. All these folks are building a new way of life and offer hope, joy, friendship, and community resilience as alternatives to corporate power, environmental destruction, and the dismantling of our democratic structures. So become involved at any and all levels. Please stick around afterwards to discuss, share, and find out more. Thank you.
We'll open up in a few minutes for some questions and comments, and then we'll have time for closing as well. Dr. Wade Davis is here. He's our fourth speaker. Explorer in residence, the National Geographic Society. He's a visiting professor and senior fellow of the Masters in Development Practice, Indigenous Development Program here at the University of Winnipeg, and author of Sacred Headwaters, The Fight to Save the Stikine, Skeena, and Nass. Dr. Wade Davis.
Well, I'd like to thank all my fellow panelists, and most I'd like to thank all of you from Manitoba who have come out to support us from British Columbia. You know, my mother used to work in the Hudson Bay store right across Kitty Corner from here, and my grandfather actually died of Spanish flu in the streets of Calgary. My grandparents on my father's side were killed in a car accident on the Malahat Highway. And my great uncle was a fisherman off the shore of Newfoundland. You see, this isn't about British Columbia or Manitoba, it's about Canada. And we're all Canadians. And those who try to divide us by saying that somehow outsiders are sparking this resistance reflect the kind of ideological thrust of their position. You know, I was at Copenhagen. And it wasn't a proud moment for Canada. It wasn't actually a proud moment for any nation state. There you had China speaking about being allowed to increase their carbon intensity as long as it didn't surpass the steroidal growth of their economy, reducing carbon emissions only to the point where they could continue to grow. You had India basically saying, you screwed up the world for 200 years, it's our turn. You had the European Union calling for reductions that no other nation could match simply because through a sleight of hand by accepting the former countries of the Soviet bloc, they had achieved those reductions themselves without actually reducing anything of their carbon emissions. Saudi Arabia asked for compensation and the countries of Africa asked for reparations as if there had been a carbon conspiracy afoot since the birth of colonialism. Canada, of course, was famously mute, and it was a real turning point in our history, where for the first truly multilateral conference on an issue upon which turned the fulcrum of the world, we had no leadership voice whatsoever. And what I found when I was over there as a kind of ethnographic observer was that the interesting thing was that the consensus in the scientific community was so absolute and complete that to question it was to question in the methodology of science itself, and yet the methodology of science is the foundation of modernity. So what we're really seeing is that individuals were cherry-picking their science, accepting science when it delivered us the miraculous achievements of medicine, and then denying that same methodology when it warned us of an impending crisis in terms of the climate. And I think all of us had this sense that as oil production declined as we thought it might do in the 1970s and 80s as natural gas declined, that somehow there'd be this generous or relatively simple transition to some kind of sustainable, transitional, and then alternative source of energy in our economy. Well, now with the discovery of so many new sources of hydrocarbon, alternative sources from the tar sands to coal bed methane, shale, fracking, we're suddenly discovering that we will have carbon with us for at least 300 years. So we really face a choice. We either want to do what many of my friends in Alberta have done, endorse and embrace ideology as a way of denying reality and therefore continuing the old traditional ways. And if we choose that path, all I can say is we better hope that the climate scientists and the universal consensus of the modern scientific community is somehow wrong. Maybe it could be, but I certainly have my doubts. Now, those images you saw as you walked in here, and I'm sorry that we had so much illumination here that you couldn't quite see them in all their glory, were photographs taken from my homeland, the sacred Headwaters, this remarkable place in British Columbia where by an accident, perhaps a miracle of geography, three of our most important salmon rivers, the Stikine, the Nass, and the Skeena, are born in the same meadows. In a long day, you can follow the tracks of white wolves and grizzly, caribou and moose, and walk through the meadows that give rise to the rivers, the salmon rivers of home that in turn cradled all the great civilizations of the Northwest Coast, the Tlingit, the Haida, the Haisla, the Nishka, the Gitsanwitsuitan, and of course the Tahltan. And the only place I know in the world where such a wonder of geography occurs is in Tibet, on the slopes of Mount Kailash, a mountain sacred to 3 billion people, from the base of which flow three of the most important rivers of Asia, the Brahmaputra, the Indus, and the Sutlej, and metaphorically and mystically, the Mother Ganga itself. Now that landscape is considered so sacrosanct to the 3 billion people who live downstream, be they Hindu, Jain, or Buddhist, that not only are you not allowed to step on Mount Kailash or climb it, you couldn't conceivably propose industrial infrastructure unless you wanted to shame your lineage for all time. Yet we discover that in Canada we treat the land very differently. What I find fascinating as we consider all of these developments, and it's important to remember that the Enbridge pipeline is just this sort of iconic symbol of a much bigger process, which is a tsunami of development in the north in reaction to the global increase in commodity prices. Now, this increase in commodity prices for a natural resource-driven economy is actually a fantastic opportunity because it allows us for once not to be in a buyer's market, but a seller's market. What I mean by that is traditionally in Canada, if a company came into a small town in northern Manitoba or Ontario, proposed a certain industrial initiative, the civic leaders had no choice but to accept the terms of that company for fear of losing the economic opportunity for their people. But we know that with this commodity increase that's not going to go away, we have the luxury of saying no and defining the terms by which we want to put in developments where we want to put them. So the issue isn't mining or no mining, gas or no mining, or no gas, oil or no gas, but mines where, at what pace, on what terms, at what cost to the environment, and for whose benefit. That actually allows us an opportunity to begin this process of moving away from this kind of antiquated resource-driven economy into an economy of the imagination. I've always felt, as a British Columbian, arguing for years now about seeking ways to transition our economy. Here we are, one of the richest countries on earth, incredibly educated populace, with any number of capacities for ingenuity and innovation, extraordinarily solid financial foundations, and yet we continue to elect these political leaders who tell us that the only way we can generate economic activity is to violate our own patrimony, the landscape, which is in fact the inheritance of our children. That's not a dearth of economic opportunities, it's an absence of imagination on the from the people that we elect to government. And the other thing we have to recognize is that the way we treat landscape is rooted in an ideology of the past. Think of that. What does it take to establish a mine in Canada? Well, you know, you get together on a golf course in Toronto, you cobble together a company with less history than my dog, you get online and you secure the subsurface rights to a place you've never been, the stories you've never heard, the pain of a long winter you've never experienced, nor the promise of a bright spring, and as long as you can guarantee the government a flow of revenue in the form of either royalties or taxation, you by definition, you and your small cohort, secure the legal right to transform that land forever. Yet there's not a single metric in the calculus that rationalizes the industrialization of the wild that places any metric of value on the land transformed, or conversely, any cost to the commons, the rest of us who don't own stock in the company, who don't work in the mine, implicit in its transformation. Now we take that as a given because it's the way we industrialize the wild. But if you look at it through the anthropological lens, it's highly anomalous behavior. It's a little bit like me coming into your garden in Winnipeg on a bright spring day and your roses have bloomed and you're selling roses, so I offer to buy all your roses. You sell all your roses, you're happy, I walk away, but I say over my shoulder, by the way, as a consequence of this transaction, I'm destroying your house. And you say, wait a minute, who's going to compensate me for the house? I say, I don't care. I'm buying roses. I'm buying coal. In fact, didn't I pay the sales tax on those roses? I certainly did. And the royalties from these roses. But I leave your house devastated. And that's exactly what we do. And one of the challenges is that we love the idea of the North in Canada, but we never go there. I remember when I went to speak to Premier Campbell about the unfolding situation in Northwest British Columbia, I was astonished to find that my own premier had never visited a quarter of the province. Can you imagine an American governor who had never visited a quarter of Illinois? It was inconceivable. But that's exactly what happens. Where I live in the sacred headwaters, it is so beautiful, as I hope those images began to show you. This is the kind of place you could hide England and then the English would never find it. In the lower 48, the furthest you can get away from a maintained road is 20 miles in the northwest corner of British Columbia, where all this is happening. There's one road, a narrow ribbon of asphalt that links the Yellowhead to the Alcan in the Yukon. The Grand Canyon of the Colorado is visited by 5 million people every day and 24,000 people float it every summer. Our greatest canyon in Canada, most of you probably can't name, the Grand Canyon of the Stikine. In all of history, less than 50 kayakers of world-class capacity have gotten through. No rafts ever made it. It's a K2 of whitewater challenges. Only 4 tall tan men have ever walked the length of the canyon. This is a kind of place that you can't even imagine the beauty that is at stake. Right across from the home where I live is a mountain known to the Tahltan people as Tolagan, the beautiful valley. It is a wildlife sanctuary in the sky. It is a residence of the largest population of stone sheep in the world. It has huge populations of grizzly bear, wolf. It's a place that in any other world would be preserved for the natural wonder that it is. And yet, Imperial Metals, the 75th largest Canadian mining company, which basically translates into meaning six blokes on a golf course, have secured the rights to put an open pit copper and gold mine that will process 30,000 tons of rock a day for 30 years, generating 200 million tons of waste rock that will be burying an alpine lake, which is the site of archaeological remains and a fishery that is active, a lake that drains into 9 headwater lakes of the Iskut River that in turn drain into the mighty Stikine River, one of our salmon rivers of home. They will cover moose habitat with 300 million tons of waste rock, and in doing so, destroy the habitat of a wildlife sanctuary in the sky of one of the most charismatic wildlife ungulates in the world. Imperial Metals sailed through the environmental assessment process. What exactly, one wonders, would it take to not get through an environmental process in Canada if your very project design calls for the dismantling of an iconic mountain? I remember I was in the lodge of a, and that mine site, just to be transparent, that open pit is within 3 miles of the home that I've lived in 35 years and raised my children. I was in a neighboring lodge one day where I was thinking about an old friend of mine, Mike Jones, who had died on his trap line. He went through the ice, and 90 feet of snow had fallen on Bowser Lake that winter. The Mounties couldn't get in to find his body until spring. I was in his lodge thinking about Mike. He was my closest friend. And I noticed this character in the corner drinking a cup of tea, a stranger. And then this woman walked in, and I could tell from her carriage that she was an engineer for the mining company. Now, in the old days, engineers, and I used to be one, would wear hard hats and fluorescent vests and steel-toed boots. Now they all look like they come out of a bloody Patagonia catalog, you know. But I knew who she was. And I'm a fly on the wall where they begin this breathless conversation. This is what the conversation went. Wow. Did you? What? No. Have you ever seen so many wild sheep? No. I must have counted 30 grizzly bear. I know, and I saw at least 100 wolves. I've never seen so much wildlife. Have you ever been in a more beautiful place? Ever been up here? No. I've never been north of Prince George. How about you? No, I once got to Williams Lake, never up here. And here they were having this breathless conversation about the most beautiful place either had seen, and yet it was their bureaucratic and corporate mission, because he was the deputy minister of mines, as it turned out, and she was the engineer for the mining company, and it was their corporate and bureaucratic mission to destroy the place that they could not stop praising breathlessly. And at the moment, I felt, well, maybe they'll get the irony and just get out of this country and leave their schemes behind. But of course, they didn't. And that mine, unless we stop it, will go into production. You know how it's going to go into production? Because you are spending $404 million to extend the BC power grid, the Northwest Transmission Line, to nowhere. You don't know this, but you are. It's going to a place called Bob Quinn Lake, where there's nothing but a highway yard. But that's far enough north that it would allow all these mining companies to build their own lines down to plug in. So there'll be no talk of subsidy. There'll be talk of free enterprise. But of that $404 million, you also don't know that $130 million of it comes from the Green Fund, specifically set aside by the federal parliament to green our carbon economy. We are investing it in the extension of the BC hydro grid on the rationale that we will get 340 tall tent Indians at the reserve of Iskut off diesel generating power, and thus reduce the carbon footprint of an area of land the size of Switzerland, which is the home to 1,500 people. Well, of course, that's not going to happen. What is happening is we are subsidizing the destruction of your patrimony. And you know, I remember we've gone through in this quadrant of British Columbia, Enbridge is only the latest
mega project. We've lived through billion-dollar railroads that went to nowhere without a mile of track being laid. We've lived through plans to put seven dams on the Iskut and the Stikine, inundating the greatest canyon in Canada. All of these mega development projects collapsed under the weight of their own stupidity. But during the course of the fighting against that dam in the 1970s, I attended a meeting at Iskut, and this young hippie back to the lander stood up and, in what he thought was a gesture of solidarity, said that if they build these dams, we're just going to have to leave this country. And this tall, tan youth in immense dignity stood up immediately thereafter and said, you know, partner, that's the difference between me and you. If they build these dams, I'll still be here. The American poet Gary Snyder said, the best thing we could do for the environment is stay put. And when I knew that I would be staying put with my family on Yalui Lake, even though that copper and gold mine might be adjacent to my land, it was a moment that my youngest daughter disappeared on the lake one night just last summer. This was a remarkable young girl, and you know, with tall tan people, they always say that, you know, they were an Athabascan hunting people, so if you had 10 kids, you let someone else raise them. If they only had a couple, kids got traded around all the time. It was a way that a hunting people maintained the solidarity of their community. But there was always that sense that there was a child who would never leave by your side, the one who would stay by you. And this younger daughter of mine always was the one that at the Hena, Alec Jack, the old chief from Iskut, always said was going to stay by you. And one day when she was really little, she had disappeared from our property, and it took me, she was only 4 or 5 at the time, and it took me about 6 hours to find her way up the creek. And she had her purple bonnet on and her work gloves, and she was kneeling over a dead black bear cub trying to stroke it back to life. And I immediately began to look for the boar that undoubtedly had killed that cub and now threatened my daughter. But when I later told old man Alec about that, he took it as a sign of what I was not sure. But I came to understand in the loyalty that Raina grew up with to that spirit of place. And last summer when she took a chestnut canoe out one night and hadn't come back from, and it got dark, and just a week before, two of the world-class kayakers who had successfully run the canyon had tipped that same canoe, and I had had to get them out of the lake on the edge of hypothermia. So I went out to see what had happened to my youngest daughter, and I went to the place that I knew she would probably have gone to, her favorite place in the lake, where she could tie the canoe up to a snag and a game trail, skirts the spruce onto a kind of a promontory from which you can look over the vast expanse and see our lodge across the lake, nestled in the flanks of the mountain, Sky Mountain, known to the Tahltan. And when I came up to her, I found her weeping profoundly. And when I asked as a father the obvious question, she simply said, Daddy, this is my home. This is my land. This is the vortex of my life. This is where I want to live and where I want to die. And it was in that moment that I knew that no matter what happened with these mines, we would never abandon that place and we would never abandon our tall tan brothers and sisters. And even if I wasn't alive to experience the return of silence to our lake, daughters would be alive and their daughters would be alive. And that's exactly what the tall tan elders mean when they say, this is our home. This land is our kitchen. We have nowhere else to go. So how would it be if we had some kind of new way of thinking in Canada that said before any mineral development or any natural gas development could go in, all the corporate board members of that entity had to bring all of their children to the land, live on the land, and be with the First Nations of that land, and at some point in time, allow the children to get together and make the kind of deal that children always make, fair and just, so that for every tree cut in Haisla land, a rose bush would fall in a garden in Rosedale in Toronto. For every drop of toxic waste that went into a river or a lake in Tall Tan country, a drop went into a swimming pool at the local YMCA where the children of that corporate figure recreated. Maybe then we would come up with a new valuation of landscape, not that would say we would stop these kinds of developments, but we would actually be more cautious in where we put them. To put a mine on Todigan Mountain is like drilling for oil in the Sistine Chapel. And this idea of accommodation and consultation, as Gerald suggested, accommodation being sold to the First Nations essentially is what size crumbs do you want to get from the table? Consultation with who and for whose purpose has become an utter charade. In Tall Tan Country, when I went to see Premier Campbell, you may remember that photograph in the slideshow of a very handsome young man with a 30-30 across his lap. Did you happen to notice that? Well, that's actually my closest brother up there, Oscar Dennis. That, incidentally, that photograph turned up in National Geographic magazine, and women from all over the world descended on Iskut. And I'd get calls from Oscar saying, "Hey, Wid, there's this, he still calls women chicks, so excuse me." He said, "Wait, there's this chick from Poland coming to see me." And I say, "Oscar, you know, you just had a Russian one last week. You don't even speak Polish or Russian." He said, "Well, they don't really come for conversation." But I showed that picture to Premier Campbell because he thought I was coming at him as an environmentalist, but I was actually coming at him as a local person who was speaking for my friends, and the issue for me was human rights. In the 5 years before that photograph was taken, Oscar's one brother hung himself in the basement of his mother's house. His other brother died 10 feet from shore because he never learned how to swim. His fictive brother died due to medical malpractice at a hospital in Prince Rupert. They thought he was a drunk Indian when he in fact had a severe seizure. His sister got an ICBC settlement and ended up dying of prostitution and drugs on the streets of Prince George, and Oscar's only daughter had blown her head off playing Russian roulette with a handgun. And I said to Premier Campbell, in those 5 years, Barrick Gold at Eskay Creek took 400 tons of gold and 5,000 tons of silver out of their land at today's market value, $25 billion, and not one iota of infrastructure at his community changed. No hockey rink, no swimming pool, no trust funds for kids to go to college, no trust funds for people to get low-interest loans in a sustainable economy. Those who say that this resistance is promoted by foreign activists, my God, I wish it was. We have been fighting off Royal Dutch Shell for 10 years in the sacred headwaters. We haven't gotten one penny from one NGO in North America anytime, and that is our strength. That's what they can't understand. When the Tall Tan people first took to the blockade, keeping Royal Dutch Shell, the second largest corporation, out of the sacred headwaters, no one could understand where this resistance had come from. It had come from the women who stood up in their blankets, and it came from the magic of the place. And as the resistance grew, there was only one discordant note. It was July, the month when the sockeye run on the Stikine. Everybody wanted to be down on the river putting up their winter fish. This was a kind of an awkwardness. But then the miracle happened. A big 18-wheel double tandem truck roared down the Stuart-Cassiar Highway, sacrificed itself by rolling over right at the base of Todigan Mountain. The driver wasn't hurt, but his entire load spilled out over the roadway, and what he was carrying was several hundred tons of fresh salmon from Alaska destined for the Seattle market. So the people didn't go to the river came to them. And before you knew it, the blockade site was colored spectacled gold from all the sockeye drying in the boreal spruce forest. This was a miraculous sign that signaled the turning of the ways. And so even as I speak, that resistance is ongoing. So Enbridge is just a symptom of a bigger question. And the bigger question is, what kind of country do you want to have as Canadians? This idea that the spinmeisters in Calgary promote ethical oil sands as opposed to tar sands. Have you ever held a piece of bitumen? That is tar. It is not oil. And when they suggest they're simply helping the global economy as if they're benevolent conveyors of an essential product, they're telling the truth. But of course, behind that is also their own personal desire for gain, corporate profits, for their benefit, not necessarily for the benefit of our country. So I think the most important thing about a panel like this and an audience like you being here tonight is this is just a sign that finally Canadians are waking up. We're leaving, at least in our imaginations, the confines of the urban spaces that most of us dwell in, and recognizing that in the North there are people paying attention, and in their attention is has come from that attention has come about so many initiatives that threaten the legacy of your own grandparents. And at the very least, what we must demand is that these issues become part of a public debate. You know, when we, for example, took the case of the Red Chris mine to court, challenging the federal government for not having done its proper environmental assessment and simply accepting the provincial assessment done by the provincial authorities, our case went all the way to the Canadian Supreme Court, and in court we won. We won in the sense that the ruling was made that in the future, that A, there should have been a federal assessment, and in the future for such projects there would have to be one, but then in this kind of inimitably Canadian moment of compromise, the justices reclused Red Chris from having to be part of the very federal consideration that the case had rotated upon. So, you know, this is just another way of keeping the word of these projects from getting to the public at large. As Canadians, we have a right to know, and we have a right in a democracy to be part of a public dialogue over the future of our own country. And I hope that this movement will spread like a wave across all quarters of this country, because this is not a British Columbia issue, it's not a Manitoba issue, it's not a Newfoundland issue, it's an issue for all of us. And we've written a book called The Sacred Headwaters, and we wrote that book very explicitly with the idea that if we couldn't get all of you up to this remarkable part of Canada, we would bring it to you. But you can come up and visit us. My fishing lodge is always available and open to anyone who can find me. So what I'm saying to you, get on the road, discover your country, and then stand up for it, and don't let these people take it down. Thank you.
We could probably go on for a bit here. I'll take 10 minutes for some quick questions and some answers here, and then we'll wrap up with our guests. So I have maybe time for three or four observations or questions if you want to go to a microphone. I know a few people have to move on, but we've got two microphones over here. And if somebody simply wants to go up to the microphone, quick question or observation, and we'll do that right now and really keep it brief here. We'll go to this microphone over here. Go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you. Daryl Rankin, I have a question about, is it on? Good. This is a critical time, and we need to think about policies that'll get rid of the source of the problem. Most Canadians want the public ownership of the oil industry. And wouldn't it make sense to take over the oil sands and convert those jobs to geothermal? What do the panelists think about that? Or geothermal, all the other things that could be done, like retrofitting, at the same rate of pay? Thanks.
I think the problem is it's not realistic. I mean, you know, the truth is that the tar sands will be an economic engine for our lifetimes. And so the question is, how do we find the way to exploit that resource in the most ecologically sustainable way that we possibly can and mitigate other impacts of that
driver of that economy in the West, but I think it's unrealistic to think that we can somehow put this genie back into the bottle.
Gerald, thank you so very much. Next question, just over here, and then we'll go over there.
Hi there. My name is Michael Welch. I'm a reporter. I do interviews for CKUW 95.9 FM here in Winnipeg. I'll try to maybe direct my point to Gerald Amos. I just wanted to mention that I had an opportunity recently to interview a Conservative member of Parliament, and I brought some concerns that were raised indicating that, particularly from Aboriginal people, about resistance to the growth of the tar sands. Basically, she accused me of being unbalanced because I didn't acknowledge that there were so many Aboriginal people who supported these projects for jobs and so on and so forth, and then went on to extol the virtues of Canada's ethical oil and the boon it's been to the economy and so on. I wonder if you could perhaps nail that point. Just how unified are the First Nations in their opposition to the pipelines, and what are the challenges in terms of maintaining that common front in the face of all the temptations from industry and government to, in the name of getting jobs or resources to communities and so on.
Chief Amos?
Are we on? Well, first of all, thank you for the question. At the moment, with respect to this particular project called the Gateway, Northern Gateway Project, the opposition on the coast along the Fraser River is pretty much unanimous. I haven't run into any community up to this point who are speaking in favor of the project. There have been, as they point out, some small agreements that Enbridge has made with a number of communities very early on in their project, to the tune of pretty much around $25,000 per community. And, you know, I mean, I said this morning, you can only buy so much coffee with $25,000 these days. So it's really, for anybody to think that it was an agreement to support the project, was completely ludicrous. Currently, there's 60 plus communities along the Fraser River who we work with. There's the nine communities on the coast called the Coastal First Nations. If you Google them up, you'll find their website, and all have signed declarations that you've seen on the video there. Your point or your question respecting the possibility of a crack in this unity, I think is one that concerns me a lot. Because, you know, at the moment, I think we're well set in our opposition to this project. However, as you know, the oil and gas, the gas industry is moving into our area. Currently, there's seven proposals for liquefied natural gas proposals for the little estuary of the Kitimat River. Seven. And some of them include some of the biggest oil and gas players in the market, Sinopec, Korean Gas, Petro, Shell Canada, I think Mitsubishi out of Japan. And as you know, all of them are interested in oil as well. So I think that what they're up to, my own personal thinking is that they're looking to get a foot in the door and at some point convert their action into, or their activity into the oil industry. There's already precedence for that being set in our area where there's a permit for one issue, but they quickly convince people to go the other direction.
Quick follow-up, and I'm just kind of harking back to my days years and years ago in Ottawa as a researcher, and had looked at, and one of the most powerful tools of federal legislation is still the Fisheries Act. And I'm wondering if this, at the end of the day, whether National Energy Board goes in favor of this, that ultimately this is going to be the litigation route, and we look at, you know, the Fisheries Act, the impact of fisheries, and that ultimately in the years ahead that this is going to be the subject of a lot of litigation from First Nations communities. Just what's your sense of that?
There's no, absolutely no doubt in my mind we're going to end up in court.
Yeah.
Frankly, I think that a number of our communities, particularly on the coast, are very well positioned to challenge, to make a successful challenge in court on a number of issues, including under the Fisheries Act.
And from a resources perspective, financially, do you have that ability? Because that's where I think the NGOs from the states and some other organizations are going to get involved in this, and already are starting to get involved in this. Yes? No?
It's kind of a touchy,
I know it is,
subject to respond to.
No, but, I know.
But,
I know.
But there are, I think at the end of the day, there will be resources to call on to mount a legal challenge.
Over here, please. Thank you.
Dave Sauer, Winnipeg Labour Council. I'm out here tonight for a number of reasons that are, you know, for everything that you've all discussed there tonight. But I'm also here for a lot of personal reasons. My family is actually originates out of the Terrace region up in northern BC. And I just wanted to share along, we've talked a lot about the, you know, the First Nations opposition that exists there. In those communities, they're very much opposed to it as well. I'm a union person, I come from a pretty left-leaning background myself, but my family, definitely not. They're a little bit more right and a little bit more conservative out there, especially up in northern BC. But even my uncle, who has no love for unions, no love for the environmental movement, is absolutely opposed to this pipeline because it's going to destroy his one favorite pastime, fishing. This is what it's all about. It's about what is going to impact every community out there. And they're all opposed to it up there. I'm not surprised that 80% are opposed in British Columbia as a whole, because up there I'd put it close to 99%. So it's just something to just share with the group that it is not, you know, it's a broad range of people that are opposed to it. And that's a good thing. And I appreciate all of you coming out tonight and talking about that. But that, it is broad. Thank you.
Well, you notice that the minister, a cabinet minister in British Columbia, publicly chastised the mayor of Terrace for being so vocal in the opposition. Mm-hmm. And of course, the interesting thing is, if we're a democracy and all the people of British Columbia say no, how do you ignore those voices? I don't know.
Thank you.
Can I make a comment about that? Thank
please.
You for the comment. You're absolutely right. I mean, tonight, it makes me feel much, much more optimistic about the reaction to this project. And what the gentleman is saying is absolutely the truth. We recently had a gathering in Prince Rupert, the GitGat, in connection with a big basketball tournament. We had approximately 2,000 people that showed up, and they were from Smithers, they were from Terrace, they were from Prince Rupert itself, they were from Burns Lake, they were from Prince George, and they were from all along that corridor that potentially impacted. So, and we've got, exactly as the gentleman has said, we've got people who are telling us that they voted conservative. They've been voting conservative all their life and right wing. And even those people are now stepping forward and taking part in these marches, these rallies that are being had up and down the Highway 16. So, you know, it's a really broad section of people who agree that this is a stupid proposal.
I've got time for two more here on this side and then over here, and my apologies to everybody else, but time is my enemy here. On this side over here, on my right, your left.
I'll try to make it quick. I think it should be a quick answer. Is there an ideal level of development of the tar sands, an output that could be tied to the Canadian dollar or tied to the price of oil nationally or internationally rather, or perhaps tie it to redevelopment of the developed lands?
I think, Lynne, you want to handle that?
I'll try. To give you a precise answer, of course, would be very difficult, would require all kinds of calculation. first of all, as a net exporter of oil, this is what makes us vulnerable to Dutch disease and inflation of the Canadian dollar. But by slowing down production and by not having so much available for export, that would help. I think by taking a longer view of how to develop the resource and thinking that we have to have energy security going forward and that we have to develop everything environmentally, that naturally begins to slow down production. Then we don't have so much for export, then we don't have so much foreign exchange coming into the country that is contributing to appreciation of the Canadian dollar. So certainly just taking a more sensible approach is really a win-win situation, because it does begin to deal with appreciation of the Canadian dollar, and it also gives us more national energy security, as well as slowing down the environmental destruction. So it's a matter of being just more practical and more sensible and taking a long view. If we take a long view of how to develop this resource rather than just a short profit-driven view, I think that would go a long way. We can certainly do a far, far better job than what we're doing now. And remember, it's foreign exchange flowing into your country very rapidly that causes Dutch disease. So, I mean, there are certainly steps that we could take to prevent that. And we would also have the added benefit of reducing environmental destruction and maybe start having enough time to think about energy security in this country, because we do not have energy security.
I think that in many ways we are victims of the corporate world and a compliant government. And in many ways, despite the fact we have a wonderful turnout like this tonight and a lot of people that are opposed to this whole concept, that this government is hell-bent on finding ways to sell the oil from the tar sands. So I'm wondering what the panel thinks about the idea of diverting some of this drive for pipeline and oil sales into building a pipeline that would go to eastern Canada and provide the oil resources that are needed within this country.
Anne, go ahead.
Well, okay. I was wondering if somebody would ask that question. And, you know, what Lynn just said about energy security, we do have to think about that in this country. One thing we do not have is an energy policy. So, you know, we have a prime minister who goes overseas and says we're for sale and we'll give you uranium and oil and bitumen and whatever else you want, but we don't have a policy within the country to talk about how to make our own citizenry more secure in their energy future. So that question that you just raised about a pipeline across Canada is certainly should be on the table. I mean, we need to be thinking about that kind of stuff. But having said that, I want to go back to my comments about environmental assessment. I wondered to myself, if we had a pipeline, and we have a lot of pipelines in Manitoba already, if we had a pipeline that was taking bitumen across Canada to refineries in eastern Canada, perhaps. A lot of people look at Manitoba and they don't see picturesque, beautiful mountains, salmon-bearing streams. We who live here see the beauty and what really is there, the communities that are there, and we know how important and wonderful that is. What kind of support would we get? I'm hoping that all Canadians would support a really good look at how to do any kind of energy policy and energy sharing in Canada together with us, but it is a huge issue, so it's something to, I think we have to keep in mind.
Gerald?
Yeah, that question really is in keeping with the thinking that our coastal First Nations community have had for a few years now. This criticism that we're accepting money to oppose things, you know, is really wrong-headed. The majority of the money that the Coastal First Nations organization received from some of these U.S. foundations was used to make an attempt to put our money where our mouth is, so to speak, and think through what is truly a sustainable economy for our small community. And, you know, when you start to find out that the eastern part of our country imports oil, and we're going to send this oil out to China, it just doesn't seem to make sense. But the reason I've said often that we're really slow learners when it comes to the issues that have confronted our communities, you know, you come to Terrace, and I'm sure it's the same thing here. I think the last sawmill in the whole northwest of the province blew up the other day. They had a massive explosion, killed a couple of people. There's now an entire community out of work because this sawmill is gone. While in Terrace, the local local harvesters, which include First Nations companies, are cutting down trees, sanitizing them by taking all the bark off, putting them in boxcars, shipping them up to Rupert via train, and then shipping over to China and Japan. And we don't have one sawmill operating in our neck of the wood. So how much sense does that make for our community? You know, and we've known this. The same is true in our fishing industry. When Walmart opened in Terrace, I went in with my wife. I'll admit I went in there once. I went into Walmart, and the first thing I seen in the frozen food section was a chunk of chum salmon imported from China in Walmart. I could throw a rock in the goddamn river called the Skeena River. It's the biggest salmon producer, and people are buying chum salmon from China. You know, so we've got a lot of making up to do here. I think, you know, it's going to take people turning to the government and to industry and saying, look, we're not going to do this anymore. We're not going to be sending you around salmon to produce or to process and send back to us at an inflated price. Trees the same way, oil the same way. I mean, it just doesn't. It's not rocket science, right?
We're going to bring Josh back here in just a moment. I like to finish big, though. 1 minute from each of you. Concluding remarks. I always like to ask the question, what's next? If you want to answer that, or just give me some concluding remarks, and we'll go reverse order, starting with Wade Davis.
Well, what's next for us is the ongoing campaign to save the sacred headwaters. And so we'll be actively engaged in that in any number of ways. Mike Fay, who some of you may have known, walked across Africa 2,000 miles and what became known as the mega transect, and it resulted in 16 new national parks in Gabon. He then subsequently walked the length of the redwoods. Well, now he's going to walk from the tar sands to the Unuk River right across our territory. We've also, with the help of Google, we've been able to get access to all their new mapping technologies. And so we've been able to, at a high resolution, begin to show people the consequences of the development that has moved from Alberta into Northeast BC. And it's quite amazing if you, for example, if you use advanced Google techniques that are not available yet to the public at large, you can throw your cursor down on any random 10 acres of land in Alberta and northeastern BC, just anywhere, and you will find roads, seismic lines, wellheads, an utterly transformed landscape. And then it stops at the Rocky Mountains. And then west of there, you still have pristine wild country. So I think some of these techniques will be very effective as we move through communities, trying to engage communities. And of course, we're going to be supporting the Tahltan people in their own aspirations. Through litigation, through public outreach, through national speakeasy tours, my goal is to really, in a way, rebuild the momentum that led to the great victory of Guayhanas. I remember I was on Haida Gwaii when Gujiao and Tom Henley drew the line across the map of what we then knew as the Queen Charlotte Islands. At the time, I never thought it would be possible to save that country. And in a way, it's very analogous to what we're facing in the Stikine. Industrial tenures have been let, licenses have been granted, the industry itself has no interest whatsoever ideologically in abandoning its activities. Yet at the same time, if you look at what happened in Guayhanas, once that South Moresby was set aside, before you knew it, the Haida had a $70 million trust fund. Before you knew it, they revitalized their culture, inspired in part by that gesture. And perhaps most importantly, this place that used to be a forgotten corner of Canada, where people only asked who the hell was Queen Charlotte, has now been elevated to Haida Gwaii, which has become one of the iconic destinations for all travelers in the world. And so my hope is that somehow we can get people to understand that the heartland of these sacred headwaters could be just that. Don't forget, already we have the Spatsizi, the Grand Canyon of the Stikine is protected, its Zaidze is protected. If we just draw the line, we will create the biggest protected area in British Columbia, and we most importantly will protect the sacred headwaters and Todigan Mountain, because Todigan sits right at the epicenter. That is where the Banff Springs Hotel should be built. And if we could secure that, the other dominoes will not fall. I think Shell is going to be, I think Shell will be willing to yield, I'm hoping. But the biggest challenge always are the smaller mining companies for whom they have rolled the dice on these efforts, in this case Imperial Metals, one of four holdings they have, one of their mines about to run out. Really, they're staking their entire corporate future on the Red Chris mine, and that's what makes them a difficult antagonist, because they personally have so much to lose, and they have shown their willingness to do almost anything to create a sense of momentum, of inevitability about these projects. And we simply have to stand with the Tahltan people and draw a line. And as we draw that line, we will create a place that people will remember for all time as the most beautiful place in all of Canada. I'm an explorer in residence of the National Geographic. I go to 30 and 40 countries a year. And there's a reason that every summer I go home to what I think is the most beautiful place. And perhaps the last thing I would say to you, for please come and see it. And only then will you understand the wonder that we need to protect.
Any deal on rooms?
My wife and I charge people based on their personalities.
Okay.
And we've actually never
through the roof.
We've never met anyone we didn't like. So.
And Lindsay.
Okay. What's next? First, let's stop this pipeline together with folks in BC. Then take some, and at the same time, take action here in our own community to change the way we do energy in Canada. And then I think let's all commit to being involved in the bigger political process that really will talk about the future and what that will hold for our children. We owe it to them. We have to do what we can to bring about an end to these greenhouse gas emissions that are changing our world, and we have to become a more, let's say, more nurturing community together, all of us in Canada, be doing this. So those are the next steps for me, and I urge everybody to stop by the tables on the way out and get involved in this.
Lynne Fernandez.
I think in keeping with what Anne was talking about, we have to begin to start puzzling out how we as a country are going to push back against these sort of systemic problems that we have in our country that are ripping us apart. Alberta has the right to run its resources in any way that it wants. That's constitutionally the way it is, and there's not much that the rest of the country can do about it. We've got very, very strong forces coming up from the United States that are enforcing and influencing us in all kinds of very powerful ways, and we need to start puzzling out as a nation how it is we change these forces and these structures, and how we harness what I think most Canadians agree with everything that's being said today. A lot of Canadians do, the majority would, I would argue, and I think even a lot of people in Alberta agree with the things that have been said today. So how do we collectively get that together and start pushing back against a majority conservative government that's determined to carry forward with this kind of an agenda? It's, I think, becoming a very important time in Canadian, in our evolution as a country, and we've really got to start grappling with these issues.
Thank you so much. Gerald Amos.
Well, first of all, I'm going to thank the organizers for allowing me to come and join in this conversation. And I have to tell you, it's kind of intimidating to sit with these types of people at times. But thank you to the gentleman for creeping up on us when we went too far along.
Scary,
and,
isn't it?
And I've been very fortunate in my lifetime to be involved with very good people, both in the environmental movement and, believe it or not, in government and in industry. There are good people working in all sectors. And I've learned a lot from some of these friends of mine, the new friend. And I want to say a special thank you to my friend Liz Williams for looking after me while I was out here, for coming to assist in learning a little bit more about the community of Winnipeg and the people at work here. What's next? I think that our communities are going to simply keep doing what we've been doing for many years. Our communities are engaged with government, and I think we've put our best foot forward. We're making every attempt to work with government. It hasn't yielded much fruit in the way of just exactly what I was talking about, but that'll continue. However, the other part of it is I made a commitment a long time ago to do what I can to assist in what I heard referred to, the building of a folk storm. And I think that's what we need in our country, is we've got to build a folk storm, a storm of people telling government and industry that the way we're currently structured simply doesn't work for us as a people. And as a people, I'm not talking about the Haisla or the Taltan or anybody. I think it doesn't work for us as human beings who want to sustain a lifestyle that we're all proud of. And that's what we'll continue to do. And you're, as I said earlier, you're all welcome to join us.
Thank you so very much. Josh. Just a couple of last words from Josh and then we'll dismiss you.
Just a couple of things I just wanted to say. You're all going to want to tell all your friends and family about what an important experience this was here today and all the amazing information. You can ask them to watch the video because it's been taped tonight, all the proceedings. It'll be available on Winnipeg Community TV. That's WCOMMTV.org. And that should be available up within the next day or two. It's also the audios on CKUW, so look for that. Do keep in touch with us. We want your name and contact information because there's going to be a lot more community events of around this issue in the next few months. And thank you, everyone, for coming out. A final applause for our panelists.